I'm part of a group called Team Gre-Nable. It's a joke between Gre-Nable and Grenoble. And we are a member of Gre-Nable chapter in France. We have a website that you can visit every time. It's https://www.grenoble.fr. It's in French and in English. And Team Gre-Nable is not an association. It's just a group of fellow makers and hackers who join their skill together to create new solutions that are not available at Thingiverse or in any catalog. And we, after making our first Phoenix model, we met some requests from people where the traditional Phoenix hand doesn't cope with the needs. So we found there was a need to do specifics design for those people. And we love that job. And we know that there is hundreds of makers in France that could print traditional Gre-Nable hands. So there is some room for us to be a little bit more specific for answering needs that doesn't cope with the hand. So we are a sort of additional group to the Gre-Nable movement to produce special stuff that we don't find on catalogs or in Thingiverse and so on. We are all validated makers in France. There is in the rest of the world, but in France, to be able to bring hands, we have to be validated by the chapters. So we have to build the first hand, show that we are able to do everything correctly, and then we are validated makers. All the people of the group, Marie-Laure, Philippe, Fabien, Patrice, and Younes, we are not same town. Fabien has relocated to Paris, and Younes is in Lyon. So we are a sort of a Web 3.0 group. We are working together on the same projects. That's also something new for us, for the concept. All the projects are done by the people. So sometimes some are busier than the other one. So there's always somebody to work on the project. Second thing interesting is that we do collaboration with local and national occupational therapists, the ergotherapeutes, comme on dit en français. We also do some collaboration with local research labs, especially thanks to Philippe, who is a teacher and researcher in an engineering school in Grenoble. And we used to give them some projects for their diploma. And at the end of the year, we benefit from the research. We are also conducting the research with them to be sure that they are doing what we want. All our projects are published and available under the CC, BY, and CSA license. I know a question from John who say, where can we find your STL? So the answer, John, is that STLs could be available, but they will not be useful because each STL is fully dedicated to the needs of one specific boy or girl or man. But the methodology is here, and by following the methodology and the design we are publishing on our CAD software, and we are here to help, we can say this is fully open and available for everybody. And we already have people from USA asking for information, how we do this and how we do that. So we are open source. And we also have an open source hardware certification for one of our design, which is the Flexibone, which is mainly created by Philippe. And we have this OSHW number 8. Who are our recipients? We are a innovative resources, and we offer free solution to help people for non-conventional apparatus. Something interesting to remember is that Team Gre-Nable is not an association. Okay? We're just a group of fellow guys. We have absolutely no fund, no money from anybody. So we are working, we are designing and offering stuff just like a charity. This is our way to help people who need something. So first, we started with childs and adults suffering from analgesia. Then, thanks to a doctor of the hospital, we have to take care also of child suffering of arthrogryposis, which is another disease where the muscle from the end are blocked and so on. And we work for adults amputees. And something new is that we have been requested by a neurologist to find a solution for people suffering from tremor. So here is a list of what we've done to show what, when I speak about specific solution, we have done this Frandex, which is a joke between the index, which is the fourth finger, and the break. We have an adult who wants to do some mountain bike and he was unable to brake. So it's quite dangerous when you do mountain bike not to use brakes. So he has a part of this phalanx, the index phalanx, and we have to build something which plug on his finger, which was a little bit longer and with the right aspect to use the brake. And it worked very well. You know, for adults, we develop a terminal for somebody who has very, very short limb and you want to type on his iMac and you also want to use his tablets as well. So we build this terminal, which has something very special. It's here. There is a special part of a foam, which permits to work with tablets. For people who try to use PLA over tablets, they know that it doesn't work. So we found a solution to use smartphones and tablets with terminals. We also we do prosthetics, but we also do orthosis. So this was a cook who has a very special disease. I could not even pronounce the name in French, so I don't even try to translate. This guy could not move his thumb. So with the help of some students of Philippe, we make different release of this flexible orthosis made of TPU, and it works well. So when the cook is going to his job, he just have to put his orthosis, a glove, and then he can work just like before the disease. Then for adults, I said that we work with amputees. So here we have our friend now. We work for her for more than 3 years. This lady, 45, something like that, went to the hospital for something which was not so complicated, a bad virus. And they have to remove two hands and 2 feet. On the right hand here, they just let her the palm. On the left hand, they cut, you see the fingers, they cut most of the fingers. We have to build something for writing. So this works well. She can write now. Then also she paints, so she can do some nice painting. So we build this terminal with a ball joint here, where you can adjust the position of the fork as you want. Now she can eat by herself. Then she wanted to play cards with a family. You can see that we created this terminal, which is always the same in here. We have a screw, and then you can plug the specific terminal you want. And this is just the beginning. So when she will ask something more, we can easily add a new terminal to the socket. And then, of course, she asks something more. Now she can walk with her prosthetics of the feet. Now she wants to go hiking with the family. So we build this walking stick, another ballpoint, but a gigantesque, and it can be open and so on. And from this good idea, Younes in Lyon built this skiing stick for a young guy. But skiing could be more dangerous than walking in the field. So he built something on top here, which is an emergency unblocking system. That means that you skiing and you fall, then the system here is unblocking the system and then the end is free. This is marvelous. In the reuse of our existing solution, we are right now working for this little boy, 5 years old, who has a double agenesia. So you can see he's suffering on both sides of agenesia. So of course, he could not do anything. So the mother should feed him. And so we took the idea of the fork holder and we adapt here the socket to his arm. And we try something we call the suction socket. That means that we found, with the help of some doctors, some special foam, which do a sort of suction on the skin. So for the time being, it's still on the works, but this first try is quite a success and he's very happy to be able to eat by himself. Next step also, as he's in school, will be to do something for him to learn to write. This is a special request from a young girl. He was asking to do a prosthetic hands enable. And then when we discussed with her, we discovered that the thing she wants is to own a knife because she wants to cut a meat by herself. She wanted to push the spaghetti by herself. So we built this socket and now she eats by herself. She's very happy to have lunch, to cut the meat, to cut everything by herself. Here we have a girl, a little girl, 9 years, who has what we call the congenital club hand. En français, c'est une main botte. That means that she has a hand which is 90 degrees from the arm with few fingers, but she wants to use a bike. So we build this special support where she can put her arm and hold the bike as well. And this was very interesting, and she was, of course, very happy. The only issue is that there is no brake on the left hand. And we build hands as well. We start with hands. So this is the arm that's done by the British team. So this was our first enable delivery. The little boy was very happy, called Matteo. So he want a logo with an M. He like Batman. So we build hands. And we also have a flexible hand, which is special because the boy has a small part of a thumb. So we have to remove the thumb from the original stuff and to put an extender of the other thumb. So that was, I would say, the catalog's hands. Then we found this hand from a Gre-Nable team in USA, Jackin Buchanan, who did a very, very good job by creating a hand. This hand, the interest for this hand is that it was available in electronic format, means that we can use it. And from this Buchanan hand, we start to adapt. So that was the start of our own made hand. So from this CAD view, we can obtain this. This was a second hand we delivered to a young student, 18 years old. The first one was a right hand. Then we have to build a left hand. And this is the quality of hands we have right now. We had some special wrist locking system here. The feedback of Natalie was that when she wanted to keep something, it was very tiring for her to keep the hand down, to keep the finger locked. So we built this special design to have a wrist locking stuff. And then from end to end, we built our first electrically assisted proof of concept. If you look to the community, the prosthetic community, there is a lot of design for electrically assisted hand, but most of them are the electrically assisted hand for people without hand. If you have a palm, you could not use them because they was always done from design coming from robots. And robots don't have hands. All the hands we see on the market derived from robots. We have to keep a real palm inside the hand. That's why the motors, the batteries, the electronics have to be on the country. The next step for us will be to reduce the size of all these electronic and mechanical parts, and also to reduce the weight of these parts. This is the hand I saw it before with the lady who is wearing the hand. So when you are some meters apart from her, it's very difficult to see when you met her on the street that she has a plastic hand on the left hand. Second part of this presentation is the process of creating a solution. We follow this step nearly every time. Step number one is the discussion with the recipient to understand what you want, what the recipient wants. Step number two is to do the molding of the existing member, because we are most of the time doing a socket. The socket has to fit with the member. So we are using alginate, very interesting material. In a few minutes after doing the molding, we have the capability to fill with plaster inside. So we create a cast with the existing member with plaster. Step number four, once we remove the alginate, we scan the cast to obtain a mesh for the member. The mesh of the member could be used to print, but it's useless because it's just a member who has no prosthetic. So we have to transform this mesh into a CAD-compatible file. This is called oftenly B-Rep. That means that after that, we can design around this file. Then the design is a lot of iterative phases until we can print the first part. So then we repeat step 6, 7, and 8 until we get a working model, because it's never worked from the first time. Then we make a test with the recipient. Of course, we need to adjust it. We go back to step 6, and then we make the last one. So molding, as I told you, here we have a girl suffering of arthrogrypose. She could not hold correctly her pen. So we make the molding with a fake pen between the thumb and the forefinger. We put that in a bottle with alginate. And then when we remove the alginate, we have the exact aspect of her hand. On the other part, on the right here, is the hand of Nathalie. So we can see that it will be difficult for us to build something using the fingers. Another type of cast, here on the left, you see the hand of the girl who wants to cut the meat. She had only 2 fingers. That's the reason we make this socket, which is quite long, because we have to insert her hand into the socket. On the right here, the cast of the girl with the pen. And another one, a little girl, but we don't have the solution for the time being because she's too young, and it was very difficult to get her attention a few minutes. So she was always moving, so we could not build anything for her. So scanning from the plaster to get the mesh. This is called the STL file. It is thousands of triangles. With triangles, we can design the surface we want. Then we move to the CAD development. So we are using an online CAD system called Onshape. Onshape is a commercial and highly professional designing system. The good thing is that Onshape license is free for makers. The counterparts will be that the project are always public. So you can think that when we are in the open hardware and open software, so it's not an issue for us to be public. Maybe the counterpart will be that we hope that Onshape will stay free for us for 10 years. From the first drawing to the final test, we can see that our design was fitting the needs when we put the result on the STL file. So we see that it's really done. We are designing in context. That means that we are always looking to what we are designing compared to the receiving end and so on. It's not a miracle. It's just the result of a good design. Then we do some printing. So on the left, I make a PLA, a blue PLA solution, and a skin color TPU solution, because I didn't know at that time if the PLA, which is a solid plastic, was a good solution, or if a flexible was a good solution. And in fact, the girl preferred the blue one. So we make tests. So she has to do some writing. So you see, so she's still at the very beginning of writing a story, but she can write, she can draw, and she was happy to use now the pen with the right position. And the ergotherapist also was very happy of the result.
The contact and the exchange between the team and an adult, or between the team and a child, is really different. It's more difficult to get information about the need of a child, because it's difficult to get his feedback or to discuss with him. So. Generally speaking, we work with the parents, and we work also with occupational therapists who are dealing with the disease or the issue of the child. So this is with the help of this team, the child, the parents, the occupational therapist, and ourselves, that we are working in this team to define the best solution with them. For any case, for any situation.
The big difference between adults and children is that while in the West, children like the superhero hands, in the West, adults tend to want more natural looking hands, like the ones that have been shown based on the Koala or now the kinetic hand. In more conservative cultures, in the Arab world, in Africa and India, children also are looking for devices that will not be obvious. Whereas in the West, it's the envy of the other children.
We keep in touch with them, and our commitment is that we will follow the needs. The needs could be from the first guy with the arm, with the Batman, he doesn't want an arm anymore, but he wants a specific terminal to do bike or to eat or something else. So we keep the contact with everybody, and when they grow and when they need something special, bigger, we will do another release of their solution, and they will benefit of our increase of knowledge and solution and so on. So a very top-notch software, which is what we call the parameter-based CAD system. Then you can adapt any measurement, any aspect with the parameters. So if you want to increase the scale from 1.6%, you can do it. If you want to extend the length of something, you can do, and everything is transformed accordingly. This is the reason why we are not using free stuff like OpenSCAD and so on, which is much more complicated to adapt when you modify something. Something very interesting is that as we are not in the same place, as we are not working at the same time, we are using a collaborative tool where we can all work on the same project, even at the same time. And it's very often that Philippe and I, we met at 9 o'clock in the evening, and we work together on the same part, and we exchange, we chat, we modify. As you know, much more than me on engineering, you can teach me something. So it's very easy to use this very powerful tool, and when we can do whatever we want. So adjusting a design for a kid who is growing is not an issue.
I would add that in the United States, for example, prosthetics are expensive. They can be from $5,000 to $50,000 for an arm. And not everyone has insurance that will cover it. And even if you do have insurance that will cover it, if you're a growing child, you will outgrow it within a year or two. The fact that our devices are inexpensive and easily replaced, I think, compensates for the fact that they're flimsier and may break. And so that's actually a real advantage of our lightweight, inexpensive, volunteer-made devices over medical-grade, expensive, indestructible devices, which, of course, don't grow.
Exactly. Just for an idea about the price, Natalie, our lady without hand, has a commercial mioelectric hand. It costs 38,000 euros. So if you see my screen right now, I have my second camera working. So this is our 38,000 pesos. Of course, it's not that good looking. Okay. But it is still cheap. And one day it will work everywhere. So this is the result of a group of students working under Philippe's control with our requirement. She benefits from the end we've done ourselves. And here they adapt some servos and so on to make the end working. So let me try. Normally a demo is not working. Okay, so don't smile. we have the, okay.
Very nice.
It works. Okay. So here we try to be better than the mioelectric sensors. We have a very good idea. Somebody has a very good idea to insert here a micro joystick. The micro joystick you may have in a PlayStation or in a handle, and Natalie is moving the micro joystick with the muscle of the thumb. So in theory, it worked great. In design lab, it was great as well. But when Natalie inserted her hand into palm into the hand, the muscle was not exactly where the sensor was. And it was very difficult to adjust it. So then we are building a new hand. We are building a new hand with a removing part. So it will be easier for us to insert here the sensor and to adapt. She can put her hand inside the plastic hand, and then we can find the exact solution or a muscle on the thumb to command the motors. Here we are using an external joystick just for the design of the software and so on. But the goal will be to put a micro joystick inside the bone. So you see that we have a lot of ideas, and we try to find solution to cope with the needs. Just one thing. Look here, something very easy to build. I told you that we created a wrist lock. The wrist lock means that there is a wheel with the teeth, and then when we move the end down, the end stay in that position. With the second hand, the lady will have just to remove it, and then it gets moved. Okay. Something else to show here. Here is a new palm. Okay. When we start to use the hand from Jackin, the hand was molded with a standard position of the hand. It was okay, but when we tried to pick something to handle a bottle and so on, we found that the thumb was not at the right position. So we are trying to find a way to move the thumb in two position. This is the rest position. And here would be the picking position. So that time, the finger, the thumb, and the forefinger, we close together correctly to pick something. So this is quite complicated. So here it works because we are moving the finger by hand. The goal will be to automate this by a solenoid or something else to move the finger in the solution in the position or not, in or out. Everything is printed. We don't accept the molding we are doing to mold the end. We have no we doesn't know how to do molding stuff. Okay, so it's we are not chemical engineers, but we all have printers at home, printers at school, printers everywhere. So we are printing everything. So we are using a filament PLR, which is a very easy way. And we also use flexible. This one here, you can see it's flexible. You see? And here it's hard. This is an attempt to be plugged onto the one finger of Natalie. The concept is not finished. in fact, it works, except that it doesn't stay on the finger, so it doesn't work. So the kinetics, the cinematic is working well, but it doesn't stick correctly on the forefinger. So we have to find a solution.
I'm really curious about your interest in distributing the fabrications, the fabrication steps of the hands. What we see with open hardware in general is that you can design something somewhere and have it replicated or other places. So I understand that your designs are very specific. However, how do you deal with like distributed needs? Do you try to find makers where the patient is to have their hands fabricated there? And what is happening if you cannot find someone to make it there? Are you sending it?
In fact, we did not explain the process. Gre-Nable France is the association which is collecting all the requests. So he has a Facebook page, he's well known and so on. So somebody who needs something will connect to Gre-Nable and will become a member. This is free. You become a member and you say, my girl, my boy needs a hand and so on. So he explained what he needs. So then the management of Gre-Nable France will match these needs with makers. If you live in Nice, they will find some people in the south of France. If you need near Lille, they will find somebody in Lille. Okay. So that at that time they ask the makers from the right place, are you able to print an N for this little girl? The answer is mostly yes. So then they are matched with the request, with the recipient, and then they will build. In our case, we are requested even by Gre-Nable France, even if we are not living in the right place. For example, we are doing this special trick for the bilateral agenesis guy's little boy in Paris. And we start to work with him before Fabien moved to Paris. So the good thing is that Fabien moved to Paris, so he can go there. But it is not an issue. We already work with people in Saint-Etienne and anywhere. Okay. So the most difficult part, if we could not meet, is that they have to do the molding by themselves, because we want to exactly fit the needs. We're not going to build something which is not usable. So doing a mold is very tricky. You find thousands of tutorials on internet, and you can do it. And then there is another part, is that people in the country here in Grenoble, therapists, they know us, and when they have a special need, they ask us directly to work with us. So we send them to Gre-Nable, because we want to be Gre-Nable stamped, I would say. So they go to Gre-Nable, become a member. And then they ask, we would like to work with Team Gre-Nable. And then it's going back to us officially.
I would add that there are similar matching systems in the English-speaking world. There's one at enablewebcentral.com. I think they have a similar system in Brazil as well. These systems are not well integrated. But it is also the case that there are international collaborations. The U.S. group will get queries from overseas. Sometimes we will refer them to groups like Gre-Nable France. Sometimes an American volunteer will do the device and we will send the device. But getting the fit right, getting the customization right, is difficult if you can't go back and forth with the client. Acknowledging that, I will say that if it were not so difficult and expensive to ship devices across international borders, we have many volunteers who are eager to make devices for people, but they're not finding recipients who want them. So if someone or an NGO would like to provide free shipping, that would be a really valuable non-monetary way of supporting a volunteer organization.
I might have a suggestion. I've seen in the chat that there were some questions about international organization support or like a request for intent. And there is coming in Geneva, where I study, the something called the OSI Geneva Forum. It has started as a way to integrate citizen science and collaborative designs and production manufacturing approaches, the Fab Lab world and so on at the United Nations. So I think it started last year. I would advise you to just check on that. I think, or I can also introduce you to some people there. They might be really interested in showcasing what you do,
whether
as the friends or the global movement, because I think it's totally relevant to the approach there.
One of our limitations as a distributed volunteer organization is in fact connecting up with each other and with larger international NGOs. And one of the reasons I'm very happy to be a part of this conference is so that you and Pierre and others can in fact act as liaisons and help us make those connections.
All right, then. I'll try to pass the good word.
Thank you.
Perfect. Thanks a lot for your three presentations. I feel it's really great. So of course we can get more information on the website of Gre-Nable, and we will do a follow-up with all participants to say here are the information you can find.
And don't forget Gre-Nable.fr.
Gre-Nable.org.